In this video, we're going to talk about weighted averages. We'll talk about what a weighted average is, what a weighted average means, and how to calculate a weighted average. Here's an example where we'd calculate a weighted average. Let's say that we have a group of kids here. There are five kids, some boys and some girls. And for simplicity's sake, let's just say that each one weighs 100 pounds. Now, one of their fathers shows up, and the father is a bodybuilder. Check out these muscles. Check out these 8-pack abs. I guess this means the guy has a shirt off, which is kind of creepy, but anyway. He's a big bodybuilder and he weighs 300 pounds. So now we have a group of six people here. The kids 100 pounds each and the father 300 pounds. So now you can ask a question about this group of people. You could say, what is the average weight? We got these two different weights here, 100 pounds, 300 pounds. So you could calculate what I call a regular average. You take 100 pounds and 300 pounds because those are the two choices. You add them together and divide by two because they're two different weights. You'd get 200 pounds. And 200 pounds is right smack dab in between 100 and 300. So that's one way that you could get the average weight, 200 pounds. But here's the thing, all right? Is it really fair to say that the average weight of this group is 200 pounds? Because there are five kids that each weigh 100 pounds, and there's only one father that weighs 300 pounds. So to say that the average weight is right between, right in the middle of those two weights, kind of doesn't make a lot of sense. It feels like we should be able to take into account the fact that there are many more kids who weigh a lot less than the one bodybuilder father. This is where the idea of a weighted average comes into play. A weighted average takes into account how many things in each group you have. Here's how I would calculate the weighted average of this group of people. Okay, I would take the fact that there are five kids here that weigh 100 pounds each. So I do 100 plus 100 plus 100 plus 100 plus 100. That's 500s for each of the kids, for the five kids. And then I'd add 300 for the weight of the bodybuilder. And then I divide by six because there are six things total. Sometimes it's easier to express this with multiplication. I've got 5 times 100 plus 1 times 300 divided by six because there are six things. And when we crank through these equations, we end up with a different answer than this. We end up with 133 pounds. This is the answer to the weighted average. Now you'll notice this number, 133, is much less than 200. And 133 is a lot closer to the weight of the kids. That's because of the weighted average and how it works. The weighted average will pull down the average closest to whatever we have the most of. Okay, so if it were just half and half, it would be 200 pounds. We had the same number of each. But since we have more of the kids, we take that 200 and we pull the number down closer to the weight of what we have more of. So that's why the weighted average for here is 133, very close to the weight of the kids. Now the weighted average could work the other way as well. Let's say that we had a group where four people were 300 pound bodybuilders and there's only one kid that weighed 100 pounds. In that case, we'd calculate the weighted average, 1, 2, 3, 4, 300 pound bodybuilders plus one 100 pound kid divided by five total, or we could do this with multiplication, parentheses, 4 times 300 plus 1 times 100 divided by 5. And in that case, we'd get 260. All right? This number is a lot higher than the number 200 that's right in between, and it's much closer to the weight of the bodybuilders. It's much closer to 300 because there are more of the bodybuilders. There's only this one kid. So the weighted average should be closer to the weight of what we have more of. Now for a weighted average, we don't just have to have two things, like the kids and the bodybuilders. We can have a number of different things, more than two, and we can have a whole bunch of them. In this case, I'm talking about a parking lot that has three different kind of cars. They're all called Lamonas because they look like a lemon. Got the Lamona G that weighs 3,000 pounds, the Lamona GX that weighs 4,000 pounds, and the Lamona GXL, which weighs 5,000 pounds. And I have different amounts of each of them. So how would I calculate a weighted average here? What I do is I take the weight of the Lamona G, that's 3,000 pounds, and I multiply it by how many Lamona Gs there are. There are 32 times 3,000 pounds each. I'd take that, and then I'd add the number of GXs. So I've got five of them, 5 times 4,000. And then the GXLs, I got seven of them, plus 7 times 5,000 pounds. Now I do this, I've accounted for the weights of each one of these cars, and now I've got to divide by the total number of cars I have in this group, and that's 44. So these are the Gs, these are the GXs, and these are the GXLs. Do the multiplication of each, add it up, and I'll end up with 3,432 pounds. Now look at how this number compares to the weights of the individual cars. This number is closest to the weight of the G, and that makes sense, because I have a lot more of the Lamona Gs than I have of the heavier GXs and GXLs. So this is the weighted average, whereas the regular average for these cars would have been 3,000 plus 4,000 plus 5,000 divided by 3, which would have given us a number that was smack dab in the middle. But once again, the weighted average here, the weighted average gives us a number that takes into account how many of each type of these cars I have and gives me a number that is much closer to the type of car that I have the most of. Now, a lot of times when you're talking weighted average, you'll have to work with percents. So instead of getting the number of things, you'll get the percentages of them, like right here. Here's how you calculate a weighted average using percents. Okay. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the weight of the Lamona G here, and I'm going to multiply it by 73% expressed as a decimal. So the decimal place in 73% would be here. To turn this percentage into a decimal, I have to move the decimal place two spots to the left. So I'm going to move it to here, okay? And the decimal place is going to end up right here. So I'm going to do 0.73 and then multiply that times the weight, 3,000 pounds. That's the Lamona G. Now for the GX, I'll take 11% and express that as a decimal. Move the decimal place two spots to the left, so it's going to end up here. 0.11 and multiply that times the weight of the GX. 4,000 pounds for that model of the car. And finally, I'll take 16% and express it as a decimal, 0.16, and multiply it by the weight of the GXL model. Now, when you're working with percentages, you don't divide by anything. All you do is multiply the weights by the percentages expressed in decimals, and that's all you have to do. This is the same problem as the one that I did before. We're just expressing these abundances, or the amount that we have, in percents. So the answer, 3,432 pounds, is going to be the same as what we got earlier. Anyway, that's how you do a weighted average using percents. Now, I have to say this. Weighted average doesn't mean that you have to use weights of things, all right? You can calculate a weighted average with the amount of money people make, or you know, like how much volume you have in different types of containers. Anything you can think of, any measurement you can think of, you can do a weighted average of. So I've been using examples of weights here, weights of people, weights of cars, but you don't just have to do weights for a weighted average. The only reason you call it a weighted average is because it takes into account the number of each thing you have, and they kind of pull the average closest to their value. So that's why you call it a weighted average, because you give different weight to each type of thing that you have. finally, if you're interested to see how this equation here is the same as the one that I did here, you can finish this video up. I'll show you at the very end how these are equivalent expressions. So these two expressions are equivalent ways of writing the calculation for the weighted average for this information here. Let me show you how they're equivalent. We're going to take this and we want to end up with something that looks like this. The first thing we can do is we can see these three different things that are added together on the top of a fraction. We can separate them out. Okay, so I'm going to do 32 times 3,000 divided by 44 plus 5 times 4,000 divided by 44 plus 7 times 5,000 divided by 44. Okay, so I can split this into three pieces. Each of them have the same denominator. Now, take a look at this. I've got a number over 44 in each one of these cases. And this is kind of a percentage because 44 is my total. And each one of these numbers in the numerator are fractions of that total. So what I can do, since these are multiplied together, is I can divide this and then just keep it multiplied by that. So 32 divided by 44 gives me 0.73. That's this part, times 3,000. I can put that in parentheses. Now I can do 5 divided by 44, and that gives me 0.11. And I'm going to multiply this now times 4,000. Put that in parentheses. And finally, 7 divided by 44 gives me 0.16 times 5,000. And check it out. What I end up with when I split these up and I do this division is exactly the same as the number that I get when I take these values and use the straight percentages here. So the point is, whether you choose to use the individual numbers of each thing you have, or whether you choose to use the percentages, the way you go about calculating the weighted average has the same math in it. Anyway, now that you know how to calculate a weighted average using the numbers of the things or the percentages of the things, you can now go on and learn how to calculate atomic mass.